Special's not the word. Cool's not the word. Extraordinary. It's always just so out of a body experience for me when we have a baptism, because why else are we here? I mean, if we're here just to entertain one another, then, you know, we could do that in a number of different venues. And to be quite honest, we could probably entertain you better in other ways. The issue is not entertainment. The issue is life change. The issue is submitting to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And only He can make that which is dead come alive. And that's what we celebrate at a baptism. I felt sorry for Heidi when she came out and she rested her hand against that pillar thinking it was a stable object and it started to fall over. And I thought, I had a policy growing up in my household. I never wanted anybody to feel bad for like a spilled glass of water or a spilled glass of Coke or a spilled glass of milk. And so Julie could just see it coming. If there was anybody at the table and they accidentally spilled something, I would just automatically knock my water over. I just thought, it just bugged me that people would get so angry at spilled things. And so when she tipped that, I almost went over and just went like that. And I thought, I don't know what it's made of. If it's plaster or something, we'd have to buy a new one. It'd probably come out of my paycheck. And so I thought, I didn't want to do that. This is the fifth week in a five-week series on the whole idea of stewardship. And it's been a great journey for me, personally. Stewardship, that whole idea of the word, it literally means house guard. That we are guardians of our households. And all that's included under our jurisdiction, we're to steward it. And we've created this picture, the picture of... years ago, I found this idea of a modern-day monarch, and that, you know, Great Britain's our biggest example of that, you know, but there's other monarchies in the world, but Great Britain, what they would do is the parliament would put a law into pre-operation, and it demanded that the queen sign it, but the queen... We know that the queen really has no authority. She has no power. All she was really doing was rubber stamping it. It was called royal assent, and it was a neat little ceremony where they would take a parchment much like this, and people would say, okay, here's the parliamentary law, and then there was a place to sign down here. And it occurred to me over the years as I thought of that whole royal assent that that's what we do to God. We treat Him like a modern-day monarch. We come to Him on our plans, our agenda, our desires, and we say, hey, God, this is what I'd like for You to do in my life, and there's a place for You just to sign off on the bottom. Thank You very much. And that's very man-centric, isn't it? It doesn't have anything to do with the power and the wisdom and the knowledge of God that God can imagine far above and beyond what we could ever imagine for our own lives. So it occurred to me years ago that that's not how God works. God isn't a modern-day monarch. He comes to us. Only the difference between this parchment and that parchment is that this one's blank. Because He says, now, what I want you to do is I want you to sign on the bottom, but let Me fill in all the empty spaces. Whoa. I mean, are you kidding me? That demands some trust on my part. That demands some submission on my part. And you know what? I don't like to be out of control, right? We want to be in control of our own life and to submit to God and say, God, I think You can do my life better than I can do my life. Ooh, man, that's scary, isn't it? But you know, when you begin to study it and you begin to realize life's a whole lot scarier on your own than it is without God. And so what we did is we created our own document. Our own scroll, so to speak, that is totally blank, except at the top it says, you know, if you're a follower of Christ, sign below. And then down on the bottom it says, God. And yes, last Sunday, about after the service, we had about 200 folks come up and sign it. And I wanted it to be a process where many of you through the course of the next couple of weeks could sign it. And so at the conclusion of today's sermon, for those of you who haven't had a chance to sign it, I want you to sign it if you want to. You know, the significant thing is it's like, well, I don't need to put my name on something to show I'm committed. No, you don't. But there's something significant about putting our name on something. Because when we put our name on something, our will follows. Helen Keller said that worse than being blind is being able to see and yet have no vision. Think about that. That means that's a brilliant quote from a woman who could not see. Worse than being blind is being able to see and yet have no vision. I love that. Do you see? You know, you sit here and you see 600, 700 folks in one gathering room, but I see so much more. I see legacy. I see that there will be people who follow in your footsteps, and they will choose to live based upon the foundation that you have laid. Do you see that? There's a big difference between an inheritance and a legacy. An inheritance is what you leave to someone. Nothing wrong with that. But a legacy is what you leave through someone. A legacy is what people stand around your gravesite and praise you for and say, based upon how they live their life, this is what I'm taking with me. You know, I'm reminded that this is the 500-year anniversary of the Reformation, where an unknown pastor, theologian, said, we're doing it wrong. We're trying to get to God by following all these church rules, which not much different today, probably. And he said, we're doing it wrong. And so he wrote this paper. We in history call it the 95 Theses. And yet what he was trying to do is to make a statement to say, we got to do it different. You know, through this series, that's all I've been saying is we got to do it different. We've been approaching God on our terms, on our desires, on our selfish wisdom. And God is screaming to us, where did you get that from? You didn't get it from my scriptures that I gave to you. You got it from your man-centered ways. And he says, do it different. Follow me. You know, as the old psychologist's line, we've been doing it our way, writing our rules. And the psychologist would say, well, how's that working for you? And it's not. Because we're finite. We're limited. We can only see so far in front of our headlights. And yet God says, I can do far more, exceedingly abundantly, than what you can imagine with your life. When we truly understand the influence that we can generate through being a house guardian of our health, of our property, of our resources, of our information, of our beliefs, ultimately of the gospel. He's given us the responsibility of being guardians of this gospel. And then we start experiencing how God can do exceedingly abundantly more than we could ever imagine. You know, the gospel of Jesus Christ is a precious thing that he's entrusted to us. That when Jesus Christ hung on the cross and died, his payment on the cross was significant to pay the penalty. You get this? To pay the penalty for all our sin. I mean, it's monumental. It's beyond anything that we could ever put words to. We could write poems. We could sing songs about it. But it's more magnificent than anything we could ever dream of or ever imagine. And he did it for us. And to equate anything with equal to what Christ has done for us doesn't do the cross justice. The past two Sundays, we've defended the fact that the giving of our time and money is far more for our benefit than it is for the recipients. By the way, right after the Hurricane Harvey hit down in the Houston area and devastated Texas. I mean, they're going to be They will be restoring that area in the southern part of Texas for the next 7 years, rebuilding cities. And so we put on, instantly, we put on our website to say, hey, you know what? None of the proceeds go to us, but if you want to donate to Harvey Relief, here's a way to do it. And people in the community who weren't even a part of our church would go to it. There was an article in the paper. They said, hey, how are you guys addressing this? And we said, we're just trying to collect stuff. We've got a partnership down there with the church. And so we just sent down 2 weeks ago a check for $4,300 to this church in this little town not far from Houston just to help in the Harvey Relief that you gave. And so, you know, you think about that, $4,300, that's a chunk of change. That'll buy a lot of mops and brooms and nuts and bolts and nails and hammers and paint. And you could easily say, oh man, that's for them. You know what? Let me let you in on something. In God's economy, that's more for us than it is for them. Because if God says, if I can entrust you with a little bit, then I can entrust you with more. No, that $4,300 that we just sent, by the way, that's cool, isn't it? You did that. It's more for our benefit than it is for his, because you know what? Trust works both ways. If God can trust us with a little bit, then he says, then I can trust you with more. And the more in God's economy is life change. You want to be used by God? The proving ground for it is show me through your resources. Matthew 25, Luke 19. Jesus drives this idea that if we're faithful with our resources, then God will entrust us with more. Only for the purpose so that we can continue to give more. And so that he can give us more resources, but he can also give us more responsibility. Giving is a proving ground for faithfulness and more responsibility. Had I started with this message 6 weeks ago, you guys would have been going, no, you guys, all you do is talk about money. But through the past 5 weeks, what we've done is gotten through this to say, you know what, I'm not asking you for your money. I'm asking you what God wants from you is total commitment from him. And part of that is your money. And we've shown through the past 5 weeks that you cannot divorce yourself as a follower of Christ. You cannot divorce yourself from your resources. It doesn't work that way. To give, a believer must trust that God will replenish what we give so that we were enabled to give more. Last week we used the example of a soldier in World War II. We painted a modern day parable. And this soldier in World War II, he was hoarding his bullets, he was hoarding his hand grenades, he was hoarding his K-rations for fear that if he used them, no more would be coming to him. Well, that idea is ludicrous. A soldier willingly gives up his freedom for the freedom of others, and he knows he can't hoard the resources entrusted to him. And that's why he trusts his superiors to supply him with all he needs to keep pouring it on the enemy. And since trust works both ways, that means that when we spend our God-supplied resources to expand God's kingdom, that God trusts us with more resources. And so we pour it on, so that God can keep pouring it out to us. Do you believe he can do that? The root of our fear is that if we give, then we won't have anything left over for our own needs. But I want you to hear something in God's equation. Giving is the means by which our needs are met. We cannot outgive God. It's impossible. If we hoard our time and our money, we're saying we won't trust that God can replenish what we give. Then God responds by not entrusting to us a greater responsibility. Last week we concluded our time with an ask. If you gave beyond what you've ever given previously, do you think God could replenish what you give? Why would he not? Why would he not give you more to accomplish the very thing that he's committed to accomplishing? It makes no sense that he wouldn't replenish our resources. So the ask was to be generous. Try to outgive God. Try to give more than you've ever given before. Take him up on his word, knowing that he will give you what we need, when we need it, for who we need it. I want to continue this morning to build on this idea of stewardship. And my heart's desire is that you would be convinced to never turn back from trusting God. That you would acknowledge that he is our sufficiency, that he is good, and he can do exceedingly abundantly beyond what we could ever ask or imagine. So this morning, I want to go deeper because I think you're ready for it. I want to show you a parable that Jesus taught. And I want to break the teaching into two parts. I want to teach the parable. And then the second part is what I want to do is I want to show you the application of the parable. And the parable comes to us from Luke chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. First, what we're going to do is we're going to look at the parable itself. In Luke chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. So allow me to read it to you. First of all, let me tell you about parables. Parables revealed truth to open hearts, but they concealed truth from closed hearts. And Jesus told 50 of them. You know, the interesting thing, we only have 52 days of the life of Jesus. In our New Testament Gospels, we only have 52 snapshots of 52 days of Jesus' life. And yet we have 50 individual parables that he taught. Amazing. He used stories. So he starts in Luke chapter 16, verse 1. He says, "Now he was also saying to the disciples, there was a certain rich man who had a steward. And his steward was reported to him as squandering his possessions. And he called him and said to him, what is this I hear about you? Give an account," the word literally, "give an audit of your stewardship, for you can no longer be my steward." Verse 3, "And the steward said to himself, what shall I do since my master is taking," it's not yet done yet, it's in the process, "he's taking the stewardship away from me." In other words, he's in the process of firing me. "Well, what's my alternative? I'm not strong enough to dig, I can't do a manual job, and I'm ashamed to beg." Verse 4, he develops a strategy. "I know what I'm going to do, so that when I am removed from the stewardship, they will receive me into their homes. And he summoned each one of the master's debtors and began saying to the first, how much do you owe my master? And he said, 100 measures of oil. And so he said to him, take your bill, sit down quickly, and write 50. Then said to another, and how much do you owe? And he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said to him, take your bill, write 80. And his master praised the unrighteous steward because he had acted shrewdly. What? This is one of those parables that's like, why did they include this one in there? Because it just seems weird that you're raising up this crooked manager. Why did Jesus use this as an example? Because he's commending this dishonest manager's shrewdness. First of all, I want you to understand something. In Eastern literature, it was not uncommon to use a bad example to reinforce a good lesson. Second, I want you to be careful not to automatically associate that word shrewd with evil. Jesus used it. And Jesus used it in a positive vein. Jesus encouraged his followers to be as shrewd as serpents and innocent as doves. So shrewd can be synonymous with wise behavior. So let's decode this parable. Jesus told this parable of this unjust manager to teach that his disciples must use their wealth for kingdom purposes. In the parable, a rich man called his manager to give an account of his dealings. The rich man had overheard that the manager was not handling the wealthy owner's finances wisely. And in Jesus' day, managers were often hired by wealthy people to care for the finances of their estates. Such a manager would be comparable to a modern-day financial planner or a modern-day trustee who controls the finances of that estate for the purpose of making money for the estate, for his wealthy employer. The money didn't belong to the manager, but he could use it for the gain of the estate. Apparently, this manager was being irresponsible with his resources of this estate that had been entrusted to him. So the rich employer decided to fire this manager. Before the act of severing ties took place, this manager got busy, though. He decides, if I'm going to lose my job, if I'm going to lose this job, he realized that he needed to line up another job. After all, I'm not in the physical condition to do ditch digging, and begging, that's not an alternative, that's not a place of integrity. So he begins to leverage his current situation to open the doors for a future position. So the manager decides to go to two of the men that owe his employer debt. He decides that while he still has the authority to do so, to charge these two men less than they actually owed. So to one, he charges 400 instead of 800 gallons of olive oil. To another, he charges 800 instead of 1,000 bushels of wheat. And so this soon-to-be-out-of-a-job manager is thinking, when I lose my job here, maybe these people that I have leveraged a deal for will welcome me into a position of employment. And when the rich man heard what he had done, he didn't get angry with him. He commended this dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. Now it's clear he was dishonest. It wasn't his place to reduce what these two men owed. So what in the world was this rich man praising in this manager? The rich man was impressed. He was impressed that this manager, in the midst of his crisis, was sensible enough to plan ahead, using material goods to secure a future position. Be very clear, Jesus was not teaching that his disciples should be dishonest. That wasn't what Jesus was teaching. He was teaching that they should use material things for a future benefit. It was a good lesson from a bad example. Jesus now takes this big idea from the story to teach his disciples how to use their wealth for kingdom purposes. And so verses 8 through 13 is the application of this parable. Let's read it. Starting again, verse 8, he says, "And his master praised this unrighteous steward because he had acted shrewdly. For the sons of this age are more shrewd in relation to their own kind than the sons of light." Verse 9, and Jesus is speaking to them, "I say to you, make friends for yourself by means of the money, the mammon of unrighteousness, that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal dwellings." Verse 10, "He who is faithful in a very little thing." Interesting. Jesus is calling money a very little thing. "He who is faithful in a very little thing is faithful also in much. And he who is unrighteous in a very little thing is unrighteous also in much." Verse 11, "If therefore you have been faithful in the use of unrighteous mammon," unrighteous money, "who will entrust the true riches to you?" And verse 12, "And if you have not been faithful in the use of that which is another's, who's going to give you that which is your own?" Verse 13, "No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon." You can't serve God and money. This is the application that Jesus wanted to teach his disciples. Now, as we're doing this, try to forget the fact that this manager was dishonest. Block that out of our grid, because we don't use bad examples for good lessons. But hold on to the idea of using your money for someone else's well-being. Jesus wants his disciples, I think, to apply three things out of this parable. The first is found in verses 8 and 9. Let me look at verse 8 and 9 again. It says, "And his master praised the unrighteous manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the sons of this age are more shrewd in relation to their own kind than the sons of light." Verse 9, "And I say to you, make friends for yourselves by means of the wealth of unrighteousness so that when it fails, they will receive you into the eternal dwellings. First of all, Jesus wanted his disciples to use resources to win people into the kingdom. His point? The people of this world, they're more strategic than you are. They're more strategic dealing with their own kind than you people of the light, you disciples, are. This ungodly manager is thinking more strategic than you guys are. Jesus sets his disciples apart from this dishonest manager. This dishonest manager was a person of the world. He was seeking a way to make his life better in the here and now. The disciples were people of light. And they should act in a shrewd way, not in a dishonest way. Jesus is saying that as a people of light, we should use our worldly wealth, not to store it up, not to be enslaved to it. Our wealth, our money, should be a servant. The disciples were to use money to win eternal friends. See, the dishonest manager used wealth to influence men for an earthly purpose. This is where he's making the distinction. A disciple is to use money to influence people for an eternal purpose. This is the core of the purpose of money. To win people for an eternal benefit. At its core, that's why God has given this whole thing called money to us. A disciple's wise use of wealth would help lead others to believe the message of salvation and bring people into a place of receptivity to that message. Here's the second application. It's found in verses 10 through 12. He says this: He who is faithful in a very little thing, there it is again. He who is faithful in a very little thing, you and I know his money, is faithful also in much. And he who is unrighteous in a very little thing is also unrighteous also in much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the use of unrighteous wealth, well, who's going to entrust true riches to you? And if you have not been faithful in the use of that which is another's, who's going to give you that which is your own? Here's the second application. If a disciple is faithful to use his money for the purpose of winning people to Christ, then a disciple can be trusted for greater things. On the flip side of that, if we're not faithful with this little thing, then we're not going to be faithful in what really matters. And we won't be entrusted with what really matters. Jesus calls greater things, he says in this passage, he calls greater things, he says true riches. And it seems to refer that true riches are increased kingdom responsibility, not only here, but in heaven. Again, trust works both ways. We trust God, we give. God trusts us, he gives us more resources to give and gives us more responsibility. You know, from a horizontal position, we just kind of look horizontal rather than vertical, and we kind of look at money just kind of left and right. Instead of looking at money in the bigger picture, you know, just a word to the wise, be careful how you judge Christian leaders and positions. If a believer, and I'm not talking about leaders in a secular position, I'm talking about a Christian leader, if a believer has a lot of responsibility and they're in a position of a lot of responsibility for a long time, it's probably because over the years they've been faithful with a very little thing. And if a leader's not faithful with a very little thing, then they won't be a leader for very long. Now, here's the third application, found in verse 13. He says, no servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. Here's the third way that Jesus wants his disciples to apply this parable. To understand, a true disciple cannot serve both God and money. You can't do it. As masters, the two are mutually exclusive. Money is a horrible master. Love of money will lead us away from God. Because here's the reason why. The love of money will tantalize something in us that's called our flesh. We looked at it last series in the book of Galatians. We've got this thing. It's called our flesh. It's the most selfish desires in us. It's who we were born into. I likened our flesh as like a vacuum cleaner. Our flesh sucks up all the things in our culture that are not good for us. All the dust and dirt and grime that's not good for us is what our flesh craves. And what happens when we allow our flesh to be in charge? Our flesh, the love of money, will tantalize our flesh. And when empowered, our flesh will crave more and more and more of it. You've seen it. See, when you feed your flesh, it will want to hoard. Your flesh will want to misspend money selfishly. Your flesh will want to compromise your own convictions to get more of it. And there's no end to what our flesh will do to acquire it. It'll do anything to get more and more and more of it. But when we obey the Spirit of God within us, then we will enslave money to us rather than be enslaved by money. And money will serve us rather than us be the servants of it. And we will rule over our money, and as it is, simply by seeing money pass through our hands as we shuffle it to where God directs. Think of your life as a pipeline. God simply entrusts money to you to shuffle it where it needs to go. A pipeline, all it does, the goal of a pipeline is to get one chemical to another place. A good pipeline never stops and goes, you know what, this stuff that's flowing through my veins, I'm afraid no more will flow through, so I'm just going to stop it. I mean, that's where you need to call a good plumber, don't you? Because you've got a clogged drain, if that's the case. A pipeline simply takes that which starts off in one place and shuffles it to another place. God created us as pipelines to be used as his servants. And when we're able to give away our resources freely, it's a sign that our resources don't own us. We own our resources. Giving away resources entrusted to us breaks us of us. Because there's something in our flesh, there's a symptom of our flesh called covetousness that has its grip on us when we feed our flesh. To covet something literally means a desire to possess something that doesn't belong to you. And this is foundational to our culture. You think, our culture thinks that money that's in my bank account, that's mine. Money never has been yours. Money's never been ours. Money's always belonged to God. I can prove it to you. You don't take it with you when you die. It's not yours. And so we're simply, money's entrusted to us to funnel it where it needs to go. And to covet means I want to possess something that has never belonged to me. Do you remember Luke chapter 12, verse 34? It was that passage we started off a few weeks ago. It says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You know what it's simply saying is that where you invest your resources, you will funnel your money in places that are important to you. We all do. We funnel our resources to the places that are important to us. It's never by accident. It always reveals what our heart is like. I've said from the beginning, our giving away of resources is a thermometer that measures our warmth towards God. And that's why giving is a proving ground for handling true riches. Spiritual responsibility. Money is the little thing that God calls us to be faithful with. If we're faithful with it, then God gives us more to be more responsible. Please listen to me. I think you're ready to hear this. Because the 5 weeks, this is where I've been wanting to get us. If we don't steward our money, we will never be able to steward our time and all that falls under the time we use. Think with me for a second. All that falls under the heading of your time. You've got 24 hours in a day. You've got 24 hours in a day. You've got 7 days. You've got 52 weeks. You've got 365 days. You've got time. Think of all that falls under the heading of your time. Your work. Your disciplines to eat and to exercise and to live. And your family relationships are under where your time goes. Your other relationships, interpersonal relationships, your message to the world. See, how you stewardship your time includes how we work, how we treat our bodies, how we love our families, our spouse, our children, others, how we speak words of impact. Our stewardship includes how intentional we are with the gospel message. Our stewardship includes how intentional are we with teaching. See, this whole series, this message on stewardship is this. All of the ways we steward are an overflow of a heart that is sold out to Jesus Christ. And how we give our treasure measures that. If our treasure, our time, and our money is not for the Lord to use for Him, by Him, and to Him, if we hold back our treasure to the Lord, then we will hold back other areas of our lives as well. See, please, if we hold back our treasure to the Lord, then we will hold back in our service at work, because we will only ever see work as a way of getting more stuff for us. We will see dollars over impact. If we hold back our treasure from the Lord, we will hold back in our management of our bodies, because then we will be driven by this covetousness. We will be driven by our selfishness, and we will feed our cravings. See, if we hold back our treasure from the Lord, we're also going to hold back in our devotion to our families. And we're always going to put ourselves over the needs of our spouse and kids. If we hold back our treasure to the Lord, we will hold back in our ministry of speaking truth, of volunteering our time, of serving, of teaching. Because if we let our selfishness, if we hoard our money, then what we're saying is, I want it, I need it. And therefore, ministry out there will always be an inconvenience. See, do you see, as a disciple, and we've defined what a disciple is. A disciple is somebody that treasures Jesus Christ over all else, loves one another, loves the idea of reaching out to those who don't know Jesus so that they can come into a relationship with Jesus Christ. As a disciple, we have to talk about money. What God imagines for your life includes your money, because it will release you to be a pipeline, or it will imprison you to be stuck on yourself. So again, try God and know that He is good, that He is sufficient, that He is great, and that He can do far more exceedingly abundantly what you can ever imagine or think. Give more than you've ever given. And see what God does in you, and see what God does through you. You can't outgive God. There's no way. Lord God, forgive us. Our Christian culture has treated this whole issue with a sense of, Lord, if I'm faithful, then You want to bless me. As if You're some travel agent in the sky that's there simply for our comforts and conveniences. And so we approach You with all our agenda. And that's not how You work. You approach us with a blank sheet and say, if You trust Me, I can do far more exceedingly abundantly beyond what you can ever imagine. We bring to You what we imagine, and yet You bring to us that which is exceedingly abundantly beyond what we can imagine. Why in the world would we ever settle? You've created us not just to take $4,300 and send it out our door. You've created us to take in, to give out as a lifestyle pattern, knowing that we can never outgive you. And the measuring stick is our money. It's always been our resources. And yet, God need to ask for forgiveness that in our 21st century version of Christianity, we have, in the name of, I don't want to offend anybody, that, we don't want to push you to give. And yet, there's not one of us, when we are in eternity, are going to wish that we would have given less. All of us, when we're before your throne, would have wished, why did somebody tell me? So God, it starts with our life. And maybe there's somebody here who's never given you, turned over the keys of their life to you. And they're in charge of their lives, and they haven't accepted what you did on the cross for them. I want to start there. If there's anybody here who's never placed their faith in Jesus Christ, that Jesus, you're the one who died on the cross for their sins, to take away all their sin, past, present, and future, I pray that they would submit to you. Say, Lord, I can't get to you on my own. I need someone to overcome all my sin and pay the penalty for it so I can come to know you and be forgiven. And then for the rest of us who we've known you, but Lord, we've held on to our agenda. Pry it out of our hands at this time, Lord, and let us submit to you. And say, God, you, Lord, do in our lives exceedingly abundantly, more than what we could ever imagine or think. And Lord, that includes taking the clutches off of our resources, resting in the fact that you created us as a pipeline and knowing that we can't outgive you. And it's a miraculous thing to see us let go and you just provide. We need to live supernaturally in a natural world. You're the only hope we have. We can't put our hope in other things, but you're the only true stability in an unstable world. And so we choose you. And so we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.